Well, we celebrated Resurrection Sunday last week, and now we're back into the thick of things with our series on Romans. Now, I'm going to just kind of remind you of what Romans is about. Romans is radical. Romans is starting out saying the whole world has this horrible problem, and that problem is death. There's Jewish death, and there's Gentile death. There's death under the law, and there's death apart from the law. There's just death. And so the problem is death, and the solution, of course, is not more law. Law simply points out the problem over and over and over, as it points its finger at us in so many different ways and says, you're dead. And then, of course, Romans goes on to tell the story that we've been made alive, that in Jesus Christ we're made alive. Now, it gets more radical than that. It starts off with a message that's not very politically correct, that frankly is not very nice. You know, when you look at the world, we're supposed to think the world is just terrific and that education is the answer and that if we just improve ourselves and better ourselves that we will come out all right. And God is saying you will be an educated, improved dead man. And so the answer is not education and the answer is not self-improvement. The answer is life. And life is only found in Jesus Christ. And this message is not very palatable, and it's not very politically correct, but it gets worse. The message actually gets worse. More radical, more amazing, more awesome. As we look at Romans 5, we figure out that righteousness is a gift, that it's a free gift to whoever will take it, that again, it's not about you improving yourself or bettering yourself, it's about life just being given to you as a free gift. And then, of course, Paul likes to take it up a notch. And he says, if it's a gift, if it's all 100% free, well, then should we just go out and abuse it? Why not just abuse it? Why not just go on sinning so that grace will increase? You're not going to out-sin God's grace. You're not going to fight against what Jesus did and somehow win. Your sin is not greater than Jesus' blood. And so why not abuse the blood of Christ? And that's the question he asks. And of course, the answer we found out in Romans 6 is, by no means, hey, have you missed half of the gospel here? You died to sin. It's never going to sit well with you. It's going to eat your lunch. And that's why we Christians, we have this inner war going on. And the war is between the flesh and God's Spirit. And we're on God's team, but the war, it's happening, and it's very, very real. Now, in the unbeliever, as we'll find out today, they cannot please God, period. They can have good-looking sin, bad-looking sin, well-adjusted-looking sin, maladjusted-looking sin, but it's all sin. If we're in the flesh, if we're located in the flesh, not in Christ, but in the flesh, then it's impossible to please God, no matter what we do. We can give $1 million in the flesh to a great cause, to a church, and yet it's still not pleasing to God. So this message is pretty radical, and it's black and white, and it's in our face, and the black and white message is this: if it's not Jesus, then it doesn't count. And that's amazing. That's offensive. It's offensive to the ego. It is an ego assault, is it not? And so grace is free, but grace is so costly to the ego. Do you see that paradox? It's absolutely free, and at the same time, it's totally insulting. And so that's why the Bible says that God gives grace to the humble. We have to reach a place where we're saying, it's got to be free, because if it's not free, I am up a creek. I am in trouble. And so we journey through Romans 6, and then we hit Romans 7, and we figure out that even somebody is devout, even as somebody is dedicated, even as somebody is committed, as Paul, who was once Saul of Tarsus, he ends up doing the very thing he doesn't want to do. And, you know, he can't figure out what the problem is. And the problem is he fought the law and the law won. He fought the law and the law won. And so under the law, only sinful desires just crept up inside of him. And so law is a formula for sin. And then Paul takes it up a notch. another notch. He says, so is the law sin? And then he says, of course, no way. The law's not sin, but you put law in the mix, you put a little law in that formula and stir it up, and out comes sin. Why? Because you got me and the law together in that formula, and out pops sin every single time. But apart from law, sin is dead. So do you see it? There's a pretty radical message here in Romans. And Romans 8, I got to tell you, it's only going to get better. We begin in verse 1. No condemnation. So this verse alone, this idea, this truth could just shut down a whole lot of churchiness that we might hear out there, a whole lot of churchy operations, a whole lot of pressure-filled, guilt-driven messages. Because what this verse in and of itself is saying is no condemnation, no blame, we're blameless, no shame, we're guilt-free, he's taken our sins away. Even when it comes to giving money or giving service or giving time, God loves a cheerful giver, not under pressure, not under compulsion. And you see the motivation. No condemnation. Get motivated from within here. And so he says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Now, if everybody were in Christ Jesus already, if we were all just good to go at birth, this verse wouldn't need to exist. It would just say, oh yeah, there's no condemnation for anybody. But some people are not in Christ Jesus. And the key is being in. And once we're in that location, there's no condemnation there. So if you are in Christ, see, identify what God feels about you. Identify what God thinks about you by your spiritual geography. Look at where you're in. Who am I in? Okay, well, if I'm in Christ, there's no condemnation there. If I'm in Christ, then how much forgiveness is there? If I'm in Christ, then how much freedom is there? If I'm in Christ, then how much acceptance is there in that location? You are who you are by location, not by what you do. This is a big deal. If we don't watch it, we start defining ourselves by what we're doing for God, what I think I'm doing for God, and I am what I do. And the Bible is saying, no, you are who you are in. You are who you are because of a spiritual location. And if you're in Christ, zero condemnation. Now, what this does for us, as I like to say, is it makes every Christian just go, take a sigh of relief. Relax. The opposite of everything you've ever heard in church. Do more, be more, get out there, be a world changer, do it for Jesus. We hear it 30 years and 50 years and 80 years. And then Hebrews comes along and says, there's a Sabbath rest for the people of God. And those who enter into that rest, rest from their own works, just as God did from His. I'm not saying it's a lazy boy life. I'm saying it begins with spiritual rest. And from rest, fruit is born. Look at the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is not anxiety and work and service in stress. There's no way we are going to have the fruit of the Spirit coming out of us in a life that is not at rest. Joy, how are you going to get that? You're going to try to be joyful? Good luck with that. The little plastic smile going, the little church, oh yeah, I'm doing great, yeah. Oh yeah, amen. I'm blessed. Is that joy? Peace. You going to get that from a life that's just freaked out trying to do enough for God? Peace? Love, joy, peace, patience. Look at this. The fruit of the Spirit is soft. Okay? Gentleness, kindness, goodness, patience. Softness comes from a life at rest, a spiritual life at rest, not from anxiety and hard work for God trying to get Him to like you. When we talk about the importance of spiritual rest, yes, it may be the opposite of everything you've ever heard. And it's like we're putting the cart before the horse, and we hear the preaching and the teaching and the books and the sermons and the this and the that about do more, be more, do more, be more. And so we're trying to get people to do without any foundation. The foundation is rest, and that's weird. And I know it's weird. It's very, very weird that fruit and labor and striving and all of that that Paul talks about, that it would come from a place of rest. I mean, Paul says, I labor and I strive. He does say that. But the next phrase is this, according to the power that works within me. Paul says, be strong. But he says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. So that means I'm at rest and I'm depending on someone who is not me. And I don't have to measure it either. No condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because one law got superseded by another law. That's why you're guilt-free. That's why you're condemnation-free. It's not because God had a smile on His face one day and a warm heart for a few hours. It's because He set up one law to overtake the other law, and it's done. What I'm saying is, this is black and white. First of all, it's literally black and white. Second of all, it's accounting. It's like the law of gravity. It's like the law of aerodynamics. It's like any law out there. The law has been put in place and it operates the same every single time. You can count on this. God will always act this way toward you because it's set in stone. It's not you've been doing well lately, so He warmed to you. That's Old Testament, isn't it? I turned away from them because they did not remain faithful. I turned cold because they didn't do their part. Warm and cold and warm and cold. That's the way of the Old Covenant. The New Covenant is this. I've put it in black and white. I've set it in stone. It's a law that operates the same way every day of your lives, and that is that the law of the Spirit of life has come in, and it has set you entirely free from sin and death, not counting one single sin against you ever, no matter what. See, this is what we need. We don't need a little bit of grace, a fancy little sermon about grace one week, and then a fancy little sermon about something else another week, and a little peppering of this and peppering of that, a smattering of this and a smattering of that, so we can have balance. Christians, we got to see, because we forget, because we're stupid sheep. We are, all of us. Every day, I promise you, every day, there are many moments when I forget. And I need to come back to a truth that is black and white. A line drawn in the sand. At the cross. Before the cross, one way. After the cross, another way. Old covenant, new covenant. Which are you under? And so, as this line is drawn in the sand, we get to say sin and death or spirit and life. Unforgiven or totally forgiven. Under law or under grace. Old creation or a new creation in Christ Jesus. Which is it? And we gotta have it, guys. We gotta have it in black and white. Otherwise, we live in a spiritual duality, a double talk that never makes sense, and the waters remain murky. And so, that's why He gives it to us this way. What the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, He condemned sin in the flesh. Now, this is a really important phrase, and the reason that I underlined it is this. What the law could not do, God did. So, this is a past tense occurrence, isn't it? God did what the law couldn't. So, first of all, are you inviting law? Are Christians inviting law into their lives when we should be inviting God? Because apparently, God is taking the place of the law. What the law could not do, God did. So when we say we need a balance of law, a little bit of law in the mix, we're saying I'll take a little bit of God. You see that? I'll take a little bit of God and I'll take a little bit of the law. But what God is telling us is the law couldn't do anything for us. And so he replaces the function of the law. What the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and as an offering for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh. For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So you see that we've got this dichotomy here. We've got mindsets. You know, it's black and white, and I had separated those for us. You see how you got one mentality. You've got one mentality and you've got another mentality. You've got the life mentality and the death mentality. So these are talking about two groups of people. The first people are according to the flesh. That's who they are. Okay? So this is talking about the unbeliever. So a lot of people, we might find ourselves working through Romans 8 and we do a flip-flop. Oh, I'm verse 5. Oh, I'm verse 6. Oh, I'm verse 7. Sometimes I'm verse 7. Sometimes I'm verse 6. Sometimes I'm verse 5. On Monday, I feel like 5. On Tuesday, I feel like 6. And so we do this number because we're measuring how we're feeling and how we're performing. And what I'm saying is Romans 8 is not that. Romans 8 is a description of two spiritual races of people, lost and saved, in Christ and in Adam. And so those who are according to the flesh, that's lost people, what do? Well, they set their minds on the things of the flesh. It's all they've got. I'll go out to lunch with you, and we'll talk about how good the food is. We'll talk about how good the food was last week. We'll talk about our jobs, my job, your job. We'll say things like, how's it going? How's your family? Oh, good. And it kind of just, that's where we get to, isn't it? With lost people, that's where we get. We talk about this stuff, but none of the deep stuff. We can talk about breakfast, lunch, dinner, and great restaurants around town, and good vacation spots. And we can talk about family and friends, and we're done. Don't you touch that other subject. Don't go there. Then things get uncomfortable. Why? Death to life, life to death, an aroma of life to death. So those who are according to the flesh, well, they set their minds on the things of the flesh. By the way, there's nothing wrong with a good place to eat. If you want to talk to me afterwards, I got a list of restaurants in Lubbock. It starts with Mama Foo's. But back to the topic. You know, I just didn't want anybody leaving here with that sense of condemnation as they walk into the restaurant. Oh, this is flesh. But those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So there's a trend here, isn't there? There's two ways to think. Notice that there's not really three ways to think. It's not flesh and spirit and neutral. There's not three ways to think. Flesh, then church stuff, and then other stuff. There's just two ways. So get this now. Everything is spiritual. Everything is spiritual. Brushing your teeth is spiritual. Driving the kids to school is spiritual. Eating out for lunch is spiritual. Everything is spiritual because you're spiritual. And so what this means is we have an opportunity for Jesus to be life. Life, not religion, life at the restaurant, life at the kitchen sink, life driving the kids to school, and yes, I brush my teeth at the kitchen sink. Life. Do you see it? It's not about categories of stuff. It's about Jesus in everything. For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the spirit is life and peace. There's a result every single time. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile towards God. It does not subject itself to the law of God, and it is not even able to do so. Now, you might think this is Moses, the law of God. You might think it's the Ten Commandments. You might think it's the Old Testament law. I don't think it is. The reason is because of Romans 7. We just got done with Romans 7. It mentioned various laws. You know, there's the law of my mind. There's the law of God. There's the law of sin. This word just means principle or power. So what this is saying is, a person that is in the flesh with their mind set on the flesh, they can't please God. They can't subject themselves to the power of God. They can't. They're not even able to do so. This is why I say you can give $1 million in the flesh and it's sin. You can give $1 trillion in the flesh and it's not of God. We're not even able to do anything that's of God because we're in the flesh. So the only answer is to be in the Spirit. And that's what happens at salvation. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Now, this sounds really nasty. I mean, I know that it sounds really mean, right? I mean, come on, God, grade on a curve, would you? Come on, God. I mean, there's people out there making real efforts. So it sounds really mean on the surface, I guess. But here's, as a believer in Jesus Christ, here's what I hope you take away. Do you see how black and white it is? Now, the good news is you're in. You're in Christ. And if you're in Christ, no condemnation. And if you're in the flesh, you cannot please God. And it's one or the other. It's not both. And it's not in the middle. It's not a hybrid. So that's the beauty of this message. Who are you in? And if you're in, well, then just how good is it? Have you thought about how good it is? I mean, have you really thought about how good it is to be in Christ? However, you are not in the flesh. Hello, can we get any clearer? See, I'm not making this stuff up. Yeah, basically, I'm just pushing a button. It's kind of a dumb job, really. You think about it. What am I doing up here? You are not in the flesh. Gosh, wow. Thank you, Jesus. You are in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, but if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he's not belonged to Him. Then 5 minutes later, we get out of church, we're talking to our friend, he says, yeah, I think it's great that you're a Christian, but now all you need is the Spirit. Really? But have you seen Romans 8, verse 9? Because I've got the Spirit, and if I don't have the Spirit, I don't even belong to Him. Oh, no, I know you've received Jesus. I'm talking about the Holy Spirit. Different. No, it's called the Spirit of Christ. He did that for a reason, I think. Don't say it's the Son and then later it's the Spirit. It's the Spirit of Christ. And you've either got the Spirit of Christ and you belong to Him, or you don't have the Spirit and you don't belong to Him. But it's not a game of both. But what we find today is we go shopping for gospels. That's what we've got. Flavors of gospel out there. Lots of gospels. We go shopping for gospels. And you will find one that says, oh yeah, you're saved. You've got Jesus as your Savior, Jesus as your Lord, but now you need a second baptism, another blessing, more of the Spirit, or you don't have the Spirit yet. And let me take you to the book of Acts, where there's some missing information, but there's a few verses here where something happened in the early church where they hadn't heard about the Holy Spirit yet. You know, some apostles roll into town and say, have you heard of the Holy Spirit? They say, no. And then he tells them about the Holy Spirit and they receive the Holy Spirit. So therefore, you must not have the Holy Spirit. Makes no sense at all. Yeah, There was a time in the early church where people had heard a smidgen of the gospel in this town and a little bit of the gospel in this town, and there's no epistles floating around. There's no leather-bound Bible, and so people are getting bits and pieces and bits and pieces, and Paul or Peter or James or John, they show up somewhere and they say, "What have you heard so far? Because we'll fill in the gaps for you." Oh, we've heard about John the Baptist. Oh, we've heard about repentance from all of our sins. We've heard about stop sinning and turn. Oh, sounds great, but have you heard about Jesus Christ crucified, buried, and raised to give you his spirit? Oh, hadn't heard that yet. Well, let me tell you a little story. And then they receive the Holy Spirit. Don't get your doctrine from some event that happened with very few details to go on. That's like me standing up here saying, if you ever disobey God, I promise you a whale will swoop in and swallow you. Swallow you whole for 3 days. You'll come out stomach acid all over. Should I start maybe next week's lesson? See, I'd be getting doctrine from one historical event. Let's get our doctrine as God paints it across many books of the Bible and gives us the big picture with tons of explanation, rather than cherry picking a verse here or there to try to get it to fit and say, you need to go shopping for more of Jesus like I've got. If you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, but if anyone does not have the Spirit and doesn't belong to him, again, it's black and white. Thank you, Jesus. If Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness, you know, people will say, oh, yeah, you're righteous positionally. Yeah, God sees you as righteous. You know, here's this Jesus filter, right? And he kind of spins it around, and every time he comes to you, he's looking at you through this filter, right? But if you move the filter, well, then there you are in all of your sinful, wicked ugliness. But we'll keep the filter up, thank God. And then when the filter's down, he kind of just looks away and says, yeah, I see you. You're nasty, but I see you. So that's called positional righteousness in the theology books. The Jesus glasses, the Jesus filter, positional righteousness. Now, what I want you to see here, what does it say about the righteousness? It says your spirit is alive. Okay? That's here and now. You've got a human spirit. You got a spirit, a soul, and a body. Righteousness came in and made your spirit alive. So God's not pretending. He's not pretending that you're righteous. He made you alive and righteous. So your righteousness is just as real as your aliveness. Your aliveness is because of righteousness. Your righteousness is because of your aliveness. Do you see what I'm saying? I don't say positionally Jesus lives in me. I don't say positionally I'm alive to God. I don't say positionally Jesus came into my heart. I say Jesus came into my heart. He lives there. It's real. And so is your righteousness. And that's why sin just doesn't fit, because the righteousness is real, and it's now. But if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead, well, He won't stop at your spirit and your soul. He'll go on, and He will also give life to your body through His Spirit who dwells in you. People debate this, and I don't know the answer. I mean, I really don't. I've debated it for years. Does this mean heaven? Does this mean the resurrection body? Or does this mean that right now, with your mortal body, that Christ expresses Himself through us, through our hands, our feet, our lips, as we encourage people? I think probably, you know, is it heaven or is it now? I think probably the answer is yes. That He gives life now to our mortal bodies as we present our bodies to Him, and they become a tool for His purposes. And then one day, they become Miracle-Gro and get entirely replaced with a new resurrection body. So then, brethren, we're under obligation not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. This doesn't mean evil, guilt-ridden, horrible obligation. It means, no, there's no condemnation, but think about all that God has done. And isn't this welling up within you? So then, brethren, we're under obligation not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you're still in that life, you know, if you're living according to the flesh, you got to die. You got to be crucified with Christ. But if by the Spirit you're putting to death the deeds of the body, you'll live, lost and saved. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. See, now again, you know, this is the paradox of Christianity. I mean, I could get up here for 50 Sundays in a row and I could bounce around this stage, because that's what I kind of do, bounce. Could bounce around this stage and say, you got to be led by the Spirit. You got to be led by the Spirit. You better be led by the Spirit. You should be led by the Spirit. You need to be led by the Spirit. But that's not what this says. This says we are being led by the Spirit. If you're a child of God, you are being led by the Spirit. I know we cooperate. I know we walk in step with Him. All I'm saying is God's not leading some of His children. It's not that God is involved in some of His children's lives. God is equally involved in every child's life. Yeah, He can do that. I don't know how He does it. I've got one kid, and I have enough trouble with that. But He is equally involved in every child's life. So all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are children of God. Now, what does this mean for you? Think about what this means, okay? I am not a missionary in Africa. I'm not. And apparently you're not either. Right? So you're not Billy Graham. I'm not Billy Graham. You're not a missionary in some foreign land at this time. I'm not either. But apparently we're being led 100%. So what this Christian culture has done to us, I'm afraid, is this. Is it says Christ wants to be your mission work. Christ wants to be your religion. And the Bible is saying, no, Christ wants to be your life. So the point of that is, God loves all of His kids the same. God's leading every single kid, and that means you. And He's leading us 100%. He's involved. Don't try to measure it with some mission work measuring. Don't try to measure it with door-to-door witnessing. Don't try to measure it with church volunteering. Don't try to measure it with money. Don't try to measure it in any way. Just say, I'm a kid. Thank you, Father, that I'm your kid. And I want to be led by you, no matter what it means. Even if it means a normal life. Yeah. Because see, some of us in the room were scared that, oh, if I get led by Him, who knows what He'll... No. God says He works in us to will and to do of His good pleasure. Don't worry, you're going to want it. He works in our hearts and minds. He doesn't just give messages to our mind, go do that. I said, go do that. No. He works in our hearts and our minds to will and to do. We've got a good dad, and you can trust Him. In fact, He says He's already leading you. What if He's already your life? What if He's already involved? What if we just got to wake up and recognize it? All who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. Why? Because you haven't received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you've received a spirit of adoption as sons by which we cry out, Daddy, there's that Daddy. Daddy, save me. Daddy, I'm freaking out. Daddy, help. Daddy, I need comfort. Daddy, this doesn't sound very King Jamesy. Daddy, I'm hurting. Daddy, if there's any other way, Daddy, I've got no strength apart from you. Daddy, I feel helpless. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we're children of God. We're praying those prayers. We're crying out to Daddy. The Spirit's answer is this: you're my kid. You're my kid. You're my kid. And I love you deeply. And if children, heirs also, heirs of God, and fellow heirs get to inherit everything Christ gets, fellow heirs with Christ, that's just crazy. If indeed, right now in this world, we're not in the flesh, and if we're not in the flesh, if we're in the Spirit, guess what? There is suffering. There's suffering on the horizon. There's conflict. We're not of this world. We're strangers. We're aliens. And so, you know, if we're suffering with Him, then guess what? We're doing it so that we can also be glorified with Him. It's not that the suffering earns glory. Jesus gave us glory as He prayed in that garden. He said, "The glory that you've given to me, I've given to them." But it's going to cause conflict on planet Earth. If you're a Christian, you will suffer with Jesus. And the good news, in the midst of that suffering, suffering produces a weird, strange perseverance. It's not the world's kind of perseverance, like an athlete who trains and gets stronger and stronger within themselves. It's a weird kind of perseverance where we feel our strength waning and someone else is taking over. Someone else is living the life that we can't live. So what do we see today? No condemnation. God's not a motivator by guilt. He's not a motivator by pressure. He's not a passive-aggressive, "Well, you don't have to, but I kind of think you should." No, He works in us to will and to do. And wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. Freedom. Is Christ in you? It's His life in us forever. Let's pray together. Father, wow. What can we say but wow? Thank you, Father, for this black and white, in-our-face gospel that says no condemnation, no guilt, total forgiveness, total freedom, a new identity. It's black and white and it's in our face. And what are we going to say but wow and thank you? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Spirit, for bearing witness over and over that this is the truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Sing our God. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Maybe you're at a time in your life right now where you just don't know, you don't know how to pray. Maybe you don't even know what God's up to in your life. We all get to that point in one way or another. Seems like what God is saying is, you know, real peace in our lives. It doesn't come from new circumstances. It comes from new covenant thinking, even in the same old circumstances. New covenant thinking, in the same old circumstances. Oh, our circumstances, they may change in a day, in a week, in a month, but in the meantime, whether they change or not, we've got life. We've got the life of Christ Jesus in us, no matter what. You're a forgiven person. Do you know that? You're not being forgiven. You're a forgiven person. You are a person that lives in the realm of grace, no matter what. You are a person who has been adopted by God Himself. You are a person that now houses the life of Christ. Congratulations. Our God. Our God has done it, and He has done it just right. Have a great day.